I'm Bruce Bugbee, president of Apogee Instruments, and I want to talk today about our research on far-red effects on plant growth and how we measure with instruments those effects on plant growth. So you can see from the title right here, we get two approaches to this, the percent far-red and a more complex measurement called phytochrome photo-equilibrium. And I want to compare those two approaches to predicting stem length and leaf area in plants. One's the classic method, more complex instrumentation. One's a new method that has, it's much simpler and has the potential to be more intuitive and more useful. The work I'm going to talk about is largely been done by my graduate student, Paul Kusuma. He's been in the trenches working on this. He and I work on this together every day to do the research and interpret the data. So let's start with the definitions of these, and then I'll get into the data. The first one, phytochrome photoequilibrium, is the number of a weighted number of far-red photons divided by far-red and red photons. It's a ratio, and this ratio ranges from sun is about 0.8, and as it goes into deep shade, it goes to 0.2. So this goes down, this number gets smaller as we get into shade. How you measure these is complicated. It requires a spectroradiometer, and I'm going to show you exactly how to do that. Apogee Instruments spectroradiometers are pre-programmed to measure this and read out in this number, but you still need to purchase a spectroradiometer. The new emerging option is just percent far red. Very simple. The number of far red photons divided by the number of total photons. And any time you take a subset divided by the total range of the numbers is 0 to 1. If we had electric lights with absolutely no far red, it would be a 0. And many LEDs have no far red. This ratio goes a little complicated when there's no far red at all. Conversely, in very deep shade under a tree, this ratio could be almost all far red and it could approach 1. So this is a real simple, intuitive ratio. Let's take a look at this. To define this, we need to define the range. So we use 700 to 760 nanometers for the far red component and 400 to 760 for the total. This is not quite quantum, it's quantum. Photosynthetic photons are 400 to 700. Let me write that on here. 400 to 700 nanometers is photosynthetically active radiation. And so it's this plus 700 to 760. And the sum of those goes to that number. This is the percent far red. A few background slides are important here to say how did we come to use phytochrome photoequilibrium, PPE, and rely on it so much. It started with this guy right here, Harry Smith. In the 1960s and 70s and into the 80s, he did pioneering work on the effects of colors of light and especially deep shade on plant growth. Here's the citation to his work. Here's his results. Here's phytochrome photoequilibrium, PPE. By the way, this is also called phytochrome photostationary state, PSS or PPS. There's a couple different acronyms. They all mean the same thing, just different acronyms. Here's his results. He grew plants in sun and shade, and look at how linear this line is. A wonderful predictor of stem extension rate. It's beautiful. Building on this, we've used this now for many years to predict stem elongation and leaf expansion, and it works beautifully as long as the background of light is broad spectrum white light. This works beautifully in sun and shade outside, but when we move to LEDs with varying ratios of red and green and blue radiation, I will show you the data, this breaks down. And we have some good ideas of why it breaks down, but this is not as good a predictor of plant shape. Here is four people that have studied this ratio. Now, let's take Butler, 1964. He was the first. These are weighting factors. Here's 400 nanometers. Here's 700 nanometers. And here's our ratio again, right here. Here's PFR, right there. So it sums up all these photons with a spectroradiometer and it puts it in the numerator. It also sums up phytochrome red and puts that, adds it together, and the sum of those two is the denominator. That's how this works. It sums all the wavelengths, which is terrific, but Butler was one of the first to do this, and here's Butler's picture here, 1964. This is well before computers. So imagine the work he did is very pioneering to get these weighting factors. Along comes Pratt and Briggs, and here's a picture of Pratt right here. 1982, he contributed weighting factors to Gary Gardner, who is at the University of Minnesota. He's still working. He made these weighting factors. We'll come back to this, but these weighting factors are different than Butler's, so we don't have universal agreements for weighting factors to get this. A few years pass, this is hot. Kelly and Lagarias, 1985, come up with a different set of weighting factors. And then finally, 1988, John Sager. Here's a picture of John. Yet a different set of weighting factors. All of these people had to use tissue with no chlorophyll. This was usually oat seedlings grown in the dark, so there was no chlorophyll in order to make these measurements. But the weighting factors are slightly different. Let's take a look. Here's blue. Gardner and Graceffo's weighting factors, minimal weighting factors for blue light, a little bit more for here, and Kelly and Lagarias and Sager have slightly more. Note that this doesn't get big until ultraviolet light. This part right here, and this part right here, these are UV photons. People often say heavily influenced by blue, but a careful inspection really should say heavily influenced by UVA radiation. So the blue responses are different. Here's red. Far red. These are somewhat different in terms of how much they cut off. These two are quite similar. In the literature, in the horticulture literature, people cite Sager and use Sager's weighting factors. And his papers are very clearly written. He has nice tables of weighting factors in the plant physiology and often the ecology literature. People cite Kelly and Lagarias as weighting factors. So there's not universal agreement on this. You would think this is a horrible mess. We have numbers all over the place. It turns out these four curves are close enough. The values don't differ that much. And as long as you pick one and stick with it, you can measure relative effects. But this is the background for the complicated background for how we came to have phytochrome photo-equilibrium. Here's the problem. These were measured with no chlorophyll. Phytochrome is inside, the phytochrome molecules inside a leaf, and it is covered with chlorophyll all around it, shaded by chlorophyll. And we make these measurements above the plants. And we're using that to predict inside the plants. Even Harry Smith cautioned against using this for complicated light sources because of shading by chlorophyll of the pigments. Now I'm going to show you a slide made by Paul Kusuma that brilliantly explains this. Here's a leaf. Take this section. You can see the cells in here. Now let's blow this up. Here's a single cell. The nucleus, this is the vacuole over here. I got to turn my pen on. There we go. Nucleus. In the cytoplasm are all of these phytochrome molecules, and they look like this. If you can imagine a person, when their arms are down, it's inactive. When their arms go up, it's active. So here's some active molecules. When the light spectra changes, it hits these, and they move up here to the nucleus and interact with the nucleus and cause the photobiological effects that we see. This is a wonderful story, beautiful, we understand it. Here's the problem. Now we add chlorophyll and more chlorophyll. That's a lot of chlorophyll. That phytochrome pigment is buried underneath a massive amount of chlorophyll, and we don't fully understand the wavelengths that it sees. We're working on this. Paul's got some excellent ideas of how we're going to do this to predict what phytochrome sees, but it's still going to take a spectroradiometer. Now, you can pause this and study these. This is a list for academic, for good scholarship. This is a list of the papers that I just talked about. Butler, Pratt, Gardner, Kelly, Sager. These are citations where people have used PPE successfully, but these papers only varied red and far red. They didn't vary green and blue. Because of this, now you can pause this and write these down if you want to see them. Because of this, Paul and I designed a study to test this hypothesis. And here's what we did. There were six growth chambers, all matching, very carefully matched. In this one, we had a background of blue. Now this is a cool white LED, very dominant in the blue, and we added far red to it. So there's plus and minus far red in this chamber. To get high green, there's not efficient green LEDs, so we used a high pressure sodium and we had plus and minus far red with a green background and plus and minus far red with a red background. Here's the red in every case. The reds were the same percentage in all these chambers. So there's six treatments here. Here's the plants. Not surprisingly, we've now done this with multiple species, but the most reproducible and the most sensitive is cucumbers. Not surprisingly, when we add far red, it gets taller. Here they are, taller. Now, can we predict stem elongation in all of these treatments with phytochrome photo-equilibrium measurements? If that works, it will explain all of these treatments. Let's take a look at the data. Here's Professor Smith's original graph. Nice. Whoa. Here's the same phytochrome photo-equilibrium. The data scatters. The chamber with high blue, all of them slope down, but they have big offsets. And you can see from this data, you can't predict, this is all stem elongation, you can't predict stem elongation from PPE because it varies with the background color. What if we took a simpler measurement and we only did percent infrared, that original ratio in the first section, what does that look like? Here it is. Percent far red. Far red photons divided by total. Wow. The lines converge. They're not perfect, but we've got a much better estimation of stem elongation than we did from the more complicated phytochrome photo-equilibrium measurement. We've now reproduced this with other species and shown this percent far red does an impressive job of predicting leaf area and stem elongation, and it's real intuitive. And you tell anybody, the PPE went from 0.76 to 0.84, and that's hard to know how much far red was in there, but you say it went from 1 to 10%. Anyone can understand that. It's a wonderfully intuitive ratio. Great. So now we're going to have far red sensors and quantum sensors and add them up in a computer. That's more complicated. Because of this, Apogee has developed a sensor with two detectors, one for red, one for a quantum sensor, and one for far red. Here's the sensor. There's two. Let's talk about this one first. This has two detectors inside, in here. One's quantum, so this one does PPFD, the classic square wave PPFD that's in all Apogee sensors, sharp cutoffs at the edges. In addition to this, there's a far red detector here. So it separately measures the two colors and then adds them together in software. So you get all combinations. You get individuals, you can do ratios, but again, from this sensor, what we're after is far red over PPFD plus far red. And that becomes a number between 0 and 1. For 40 years, we have also measured red and far red ratios because there are big peaks in phytochrome in red light. These sensors have been available for a long time. They're widely used in the literature. Apogee also has a red, far red sensor, and these two peaks look like this. This is a beautiful sensor for reproducing studies in ecology, anything outside under sun, it's great. But when we start to move to LEDs with their varied backgrounds, we need to upgrade to this sensor, which Apogee calls this the PAR-FAR sensor because of the PAR and the FAR. So this is a simple explanation of why this ratio is so important, and it's wonderfully simple. And we plan to express our data as percent far red in our studies to help explain these effects on plant morphology. And one more thing. We get asked a lot about how these photobiological ratios apply to cannabis. The good news is that my laboratory has a state license to study cannabis. So we've applied these ratios to predict cannabis growth, and they do this. They have the same value in cannabis as they do in all other crop plants. Adding far red is both good and bad, and that's why the sensor is so important. You want to add the right amount at the right time to get full advantage of it. More far red can make cannabis plants taller. That's usually bad. But it also helps expand leaves, that's good, and there's evidence it can help with slightly earlier flowering, which is another benefit. So this is emerging research. The important point here is that you need to have a sensor to see what you have, and if you have far red, you can use the sensor to dial it in and optimize it for the plants. Thanks.